Good.
Assistant Chairman.
Ready. I'm ready.
Okay, Dave, we're good.
Whenever you are, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Good evening, and welcome to the RMLD board meeting for this evening, September 29th. This meeting of the RMLD Board of Commissioners is being broadcast live at the RMLD office here at 230 Ash Street, Reading, Massachusetts. Live broadcasts are available only in Reading due to technology constraints. This meeting was videotaped for distribution to the communities of North Reading, Wilmington, Linfield, and their television stations. The RMLD Board of Commissioners recognizes the importance of hearing public comment at the discretion of the chair on items of the official agenda as well as items that are not on the official agenda. We ask all questions or comments from the public be directed to the chair and that all parties, including members of the RMLD board, act in a professional and courteous manner when addressing the board or responding to comments. Once recognized by the chair, all persons addressing the board shall state their name and address prior to speaking. It is the role of the chair to maintain order in all public comment or ensuing discussion. Okay, first of all, I just want to acknowledge John Stempek will not be in attendance this evening. He's traveling tonight, so it'll be four of us, and so we do have a quorum. And I'd like to also acknowledge our Citizens Advisory Board representative here this evening, which is Dave. Not Dennis Kelly, as we originally thought. So
Dave Nelson.
Dave Nelson, thank you for being a stand-in for us. We appreciate that. And Dave Talbot, will you be the board secretary?
I would be delighted.
Thank you. Okay, I don't see that we have anyone present for a public comment, unless they're hiding behind the RCTV cameras. No? Okay. So we will proceed. Okay, so we're going to start off with our committee reports and would ask Dave Hennessy to start off with the policy committee report. Dave?
Yeah, we had a few policies we voted on and passed. I don't have them right in front of me right here.
Okay.
Colleen does.
No, you do.
Okay. So. All right, so here we go. So facility use policy we updated and passed, and the family and medical leave, as well as the non-union management compensation and benefits. That was just, I think, last week.
Yep.
Yep, good.
All right, any discussion? Okay, are we going to?
You want a motion to?
Yes, please. Tee it up for us, would you?
Okay, I'll move. Do you want to do it as three separate motions, or do you want to do it as, can we do it all as one?
Yeah, there's no
all
discussion,
is one.
So, okay,
yeah.
Good.
All is one?
Yep.
Good.
Sure.
I'll move that policy 13, revision 4, for facility use. Policy 20, revision 3, family and medical leave. Policy 21, revision 9, non-union management compensation and benefits be accepted by the board as presented on the recommendation of the general manager.
Mm. Okay. Any discussion? Okay.
Second.
Yes, please. Okay. And any discussion? Not appearing. Have a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. The motion carries 401.
Yep. Just these will be on the website somewhere if somebody wants to get them, wants to see them.
That's good.
Yes.
What
we'll do is she'll sign them, then we update the yeah.
Okay. Very good. Great.
Okay. Thank you, Dave. And now we'll transition to the Fiber Optic Committee, and Commissioner Talbot will give us an update, please.
Well, we had a meeting last week, and we had further discussion with Raj of NDDI, and I think he was going to refine his proposal to do a very small-scale study to see what the capital and operating costs would be of a very small representative slice of the district to provide service. Like a gigabit internet service, just so we'd have a rough idea what the cost would be.
Right.
And that's where we left it.
Okay.
So with the next action step would be?
It's a sub-board level
yeah.
amount. So I don't know if there's any more to say about since last week. But the hope would be, though, that we would move forward so we have some data
yep.
about this potential opportunity
yep.
So that we can have something more to talk about.
Okay. I don't know if Colleen would know this, or you, Dave, or Phil. It seems to me in one of the last board meetings was also some concerns about some of the proposal detail. Did we get that resolved, or is that...
That's kind of what the, what it was about last week.
That's really what the meeting was about.
I think so. I mean, the one other item I would throw out there is that Wellesley Light Department right now is doing a study of serving their businesses. They don't like us, they currently don't do anything. But they're looking at the possibility of providing a high-speed internet service to their business district, despite the existence of, you know, Fios and Comcast. So, and the business, from what I'm hearing, they're actively engaged in talking and looking at this. So, that's kind of where we would be too.
All right. Any other discussion?
Is the presentation going to go back to the subcommittee, as you see it, or should it come to the board? I mean, I think the subcommittee is pretty much going to go out of business.
I think the subcommittee should go out of business at this point. Yeah. I mean,
so I think that, you know, officially the subcommittee should die a quiet death here.
Yeah, I think so. And that any,
I think we've kind of set the parameters for the pre-report, and the report come to the commission.
I think that's right.
Yeah.
That sound right to you, Colleen?
Okay.
Yep.
Yep.
Right. So we'll conclude that once we have the...
Yes. At the end of this meeting, the fiber optic committee officially dies a quiet death. Okay.
Yes.
Right. Do we need any more action than that, or is that good? Good. All right. Thank you, Dave. Next item is the CAB meeting that was held on August 14th, for which unfortunately we weren't able to have representation. Dave Nelson, I don't know if there's anything you want to mention about that.
No, I thought the meeting went very well. Colleen was there and gave her management the general manager's update, which I'm sure she'll provide you some of that tonight. So,
well, not because there were no commissioners there, just...
Okay. No, it was a good meeting. And
good. Okay. Good. Thank you, Dave. Okay. So next, we'd like to get some approval of minutes. Phil, are you prepared to...
Yeah. Do you want to do all three together, or do you want to do each one separately?
I think we're good for all three sets of minutes.
All three sets of minutes. Okay. I'll move that we accept the May 26, 2016 minutes, the June 30th, 2016 minutes, and the July 28, 2016 minutes as presented.
Okay. Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Any of the minutes?
That's fine.
Okay. Not appearing. We'll take a vote. All in favor? Okay. Motion carries 4-0-1. Thank you, Phil.
Okay.
Now we'll have the general manager's report. Colleen.
A couple of announcements. The RMLD hosted an electric vehicle showcase during National Electric Week. The event was hosted by RMLD on Saturday, September 17th from 10 to 2 p.m. Plug-in vehicles from local automotive dealers were available for test drive. I don't know if Jane, you want to add some?
It was an overall successful event. There were approximately eight customers who brought in their electric vehicles.
Really?
In addition to five of those were RMLD customers. To showcase, to talk to potential customers about the pluses and minuses, there was a 2012 electric Volt, and then right next to it was a 2016, so the two owners could compare the upgrades in the car and what they found with driving distance and whatnot. So it was pretty approximately 50 people. There was about 20 test drives and around 50 people that participated.
This is as part of the Town Fall Day, was that?
No,
or was it separate?
It was National Drive Electric Week.
Oh, okay, got
so
it.
So we hosted different. That from September 10th through the 18th.
Oh, got it, right.
So we were one of five sites in Massachusetts that hosted an event.
Yeah, and do we have any charging stations in Reading? I'm trying to recall.
We don't have any public charging stations. We do have an electric vehicle charging rebate that we offer both commercial and residential customers. But in the capital budget, we have put in one for each town over the next 4 years.
Good. Yeah, I remember sometime in the past we kind of talked about whether it made sense from a marketing and other perspective to have a station here. Is that something that's worth still looking at, or?
We're going to be talking with the towns to find out opportunities. Most charging stations are where people go for a period of time and leave. You know, shopping malls are a good example where they'll go in for a couple of hours and they're able to
restaurant, a mall or something, yeah.
Restaurants, et cetera. So we're kind of looking at the area and making a determination. Part of the Electric Week was taking a survey, and we're tallying those results of that survey. And I'll be happy to share that with the board in terms of how likely are you to purchase an electric vehicle within the next 5 years?
Yeah.
If there was a charging station, where would be a good location from your perspective? So I'll be happy to share those results with the board.
Yeah, our company, I don't know that we have more than one vehicle at the moment, but we did a kind of a refacilitation and added a couple of sections to our complex, and we added a charging station.
And we currently have three commercial sites that host charging stations. RMLD owns one of them, and then the commercial customers at the other two own the charging station. So at the other two commercial sites, the host employer is allowing charging as a benefit, and at the one where RMLD owns it, we charge a rate for the employees to charge their car while they're at work.
Where is it?
The one that we own is at Analog Devices.
Yeah. Okay.
Right. Wilmington. Yeah.
And RMLD gets direct revenue from people charging?
Correct.
How much is the rate, just out of curiosity?
It's around 20 cents a kilowatt hour right now. Mm-hmm. We're reviewing it to make sure we're recouping the purchase power cost as well.
Right, because it's midday, right? It's, yeah. And where are the other two?
Paradigm.
Okay.
And Osrin.
Oh, okay.
And we also just had tiers of my engineers working with another customer who's looking at Fallonville and considering whether they're going to put one in as well. So they're starting to grow in popularity.
Yeah,
sure.
Yeah,
so it's good. I think you're right. There'll be a lot more in the next few years.
Good.
Maybe in my driveway and Phil's.
Yeah. All right.
Let's have it kind of the neighbors first.
Okay, good. Colleen?
Okay, so... next week is National Public Power Week, where we get together throughout the nation to celebrate the benefits of publicly owned utilities. So next week on Thursday, October 6th, from 2 to 5, RMLD is hosting our open house in conjunction with the festivities across the nation for Public Power Week. This information is found on RMLD's website at rmld.com. Some of the activities will include lineman safety equipment demonstrations, lineman dress up, electric cars, charging stations, tree trimming presentations, transmission distribution, electric meters, customer service programs, safety and conservation tips, and then there'll be some snacks, drinks, a raffle, and crafts for the kids to do. So we hope you all stop by. It's been pretty successful the last couple of years.
Good. So we'll try to have some board participation if we can.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
We'll get off work early.
We'll be gearing up here shortly to make our rounds with the town managers and then each of the selectmen of each of the towns. We generally do it twice a year, late fall and then in the spring. It's a time when I can sit down with the town managers and kind of give them an update of what's going on. Also give them any type of preview as to any changes in the rate as we start to get into the rate analysis, anything that's going on specific with that town. And then in the spring, we'll meet again, and then at that time, we're usually done with the cost of service, either reevaluation or the study. We talk more about the rates so that they can segue into their budget and talk more about issues that are going on in their towns. And it's been pretty successful the last 3 years. So we'll be gearing up to do that. Jeannie's scheduling those now. So if you have any thing you'd like me to bring forth for that meeting, I know Dave has asked me to possibly come to that meeting for Reading to discuss solar and other issues, which are fine. So if you have anything you want to talk about with any of the other town managers, just let me know. And shortly after that, there will be the Reading Town meeting, of which you'll have the annual report. And, the first year we kind of went from, this very, elaborate corporate-looking annual report, which was very fancy. And the first year I was here, it kind of went looking like a newspaper with recycled paper. And then the next year, we went completely paperless, and the annual report would be just online, just electronic copies. And so we'll continue with that this year. The theme this year is we'll continue with peak reduction, and we're trying to aim it towards targeting, educating the children, similar to, you know, how recycling came about. You know, recycling was brought from the schools to the children and from the children up to the parents, and look where we are with recycling. And so we'd like to be able to take that same strategy of education for peak demand. And so the motto, I guess, this year, instead of shave the peak, is going to be shred the peak. And so you'll have to wait and see the exciting cover of the annual report, which is always done by, young artists. But, you know, we're not lacking any quality. It's just paperless. The quality is still very fabulous and very corporate looking. Mm-hmm. So those are some of the comments that I have to share.
Good. Maybe Joan.
Mm-hmm. You think?
Yeah.
Hello? Member of the public wants to speak.
It could be a telemarketer.
Are we taking call-ins, Colleen?
I'm calling a friend for the answer to the next question. Right? Throwing us a lifeline.
That's great.
That's the only time we use that line. That's good stuff.
And just to conclude with the paperless, you know, I would like to remind everyone out there that, you know, our motto, every year we have a motto, but it continues. It doesn't end at the end of that year. It's compounded. And so the Go Paperless is still an efficient way of saving money, and we would like people to, if you're not on paperless billing, that you would consider it. It helps us. It, you know, the more electronic we are, the more efficient we can be here, and you know, it just all trickles down to cost effectiveness. So sign up for paperless billing if you haven't already.
Can I just add one thing to that?
Of course.
The department just recently completed a paperless campaign from June 1st to September 1st, and we set a goal of 1,000 new customers on paperless, and we were able to achieve over 2,500.
Wow.
So it was a very successful campaign.
What was the time frame again?
June 1st to September 1st.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then the winner, we had a drawing, and the winner received a mini iPad.
Cool. That's great.
Nice.
Great success. It sounds like you might have sandbagged the goal a little bit, though. No, I'm just kidding.
I thought it was an achievable goal, and it exceeded my expectations.
Nice. Very
That's
nice.
Awesome.
Yep.
That's great.
Good.
That's it. That's all I have. Thank you.
Yeah, just okay. One question for the gentleman.
Yes.
Where are we on the 20-year agreement? Is that coming? Because that should be coming up for renewal pretty soon, isn't it, at this point? I think we need to meet with the towns. Could be. All I know is I'm in my 30th year, so I think it's got to be coming up pretty soon.
We'll double check that.
Now. Okay, if you would, please.
get that watch ordered for you, too. Yeah.
Get what?
Nothing.
Get the watch for me?
Right.
Give me one of those new iPhone, you know, watches, you know?
Okay. Right, I'll talk to the chair about that.
Yes.
Okay, I wanted to also make sure had the opportunity to introduce one of our new RMLD members, Tracy Schultz. She's an administrative assistant. So welcome to the board and to RMLD. Looking forward to working with you. And as I said, you've got a very capable person to work with in Jeannie. She certainly helps straighten us out, right?
Keeps us in line.
Yep. So welcome, Tracy.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Colleen. So, Jane, I think it's your turn, and I know at least one or few people want to hear about when the peak was really achieved.
Oh, yes.
Every time I thought we achieved it, it got hotter the next day.
Yeah, I know.
And how much we shaved.
Yes.
Sorry. Thanks, Fabian.
All right, thank you very much. I'm here to report on June and July purchase power for 2016. The first graph looks at our residential kilowatt hour sales for the fiscal year. Our fiscal year ended June 30th, so these are preliminary numbers. But we looked at residential sales for fiscal year 14, 15, and 16. And as you can see on the residential side, there was about a 2.8% decrease on the residential sales when you compare that to fiscal year 15, which is fairly flat to fiscal year 14. The next slide looks at the industrial and commercial sales. We see a little trend here. It was about a 2.4% decrease from 15 to 16. And these are kilowatt hour sales. And then for municipal kilowatt hour sales, there was about a 5.8% decrease. Well,
so what was the previous one? I missed it.
Pardon me?
The previous one?
Commercial was 2.4. That's industrial and commercial. So we went from about 402 million kilowatt hours to about 393. So it was about a 9 million kilowatt hour drop.
And the rest is to date? That third number, the drop there is, or is that actually the whole year?
Preliminary, 393. So these accesses aren't at zero. So, I mean, it's just, it's a little deceiving. The drop that we wanted to indicate the 2.4%. So it's more in the numbers.
What is our fiscal year? I forgot. It ends what month?
June 30th.
June 30th. So this is the full year.
This is
numbers.
The full July 1st to June 30th.
Okay.
And so overall, when you group all of the classes together, the preliminary data indicates that there was about a 2.65% decrease when you can look at all the different kilowatt hour sales. That's typical of what we've been showing you. Historically, if you look over the last 10 years, it's been a downward declining trend, flat to decreasing. The next three graphs look at, that's the municipal one. July information. So this starts the new fiscal year. We looked at the month of July after we closed that month. And we looked at historical July peaks from 2012 to 2016. There was a high of about 168 that the department hit in 2013. And then it's been kind of flat and levelizing and lower this year compared to last year. But our peak in July was about 155. That's not our overall peak, but that was July data.
You know the temperatures for those days? So it's, I know those are the monthly peaks, but like, do you know what the high temp was on those days? You know if they're like similar types of weather?
I'll show you cooling degree days, which ties into the weather. So this chart looks at the kilowatts that we just looked at. And then it looks at cooling degree days. So cooling degree days is really how much people are going to use air conditioning load. So you can see when we look from 2000 to the 13 to 14, there was a significant drop in cooling degrees, and we had a significant reduction in our peak. Similar in 2015, another drop in peak. However, in 2016, we actually had an increase in cooling degree days, which means it was a very hot month.
Yeah.
But yet our peak demand went down.
Wow.
So that's very interesting.
It is.
And then the next graph looks at sales, looks at overall kilowatt hour sales during the month. And this shows a slightly different trend. This shows what you kind of would expect to happen, where cooling degrees go up from 2015 to 2016, and our kilowatt hour sales increase as well.
That's the monthly, the whole month.
That's the entire month.
That averages out any, like, peak day.
Obviously. Correct. So this is just looking at over the 31 days in July. You would expect this, this trend where cooling degrees are increasing, your sales go up. So I thought those were interesting graphs.
Very interesting.
Yeah. To show you.
Can you go back to the other one?
Sure.
I mean, is that last one a sign of success with the communications program, or don't we know?
We have some, we don't know yet. So the data is being analyzed, but I do have a little bit of an overview of what we can talk about with our recent peak shaving campaign or Shave the Peak campaign. So RMLD's actual summer peak occurred on Friday, August 12th. It was coincident with the pools, the ISO New England's peak. It occurred at 1600, which is 4 p.m. So on August 12th at 4 p.m., the RMLD hit a peak demand of 163 megawatts. So that's significant. We hit 155 in July, and then it was 163 in August. Over the course of the summer, we had 8 alerts that were issued. There was 6 of them issued in July, and 2 of them were issued in August. And very interesting, when you look at the trends of the data, we're actually analyzing the results now, and we should have some preliminary information next week. But if you just look at the overall load data, there was significant reduction on the 12th, and it all depends on the hours. So the peak can usually occur anytime between 3 p.m. and 6 p.m., and it all has to do with weather,
right,
and the temperature. So like on July 18th, the RMLD peaked at 3 o'clock, and then a rainstorm came in, and our peak dropped significantly. Our peak dropped about 3.8 megawatts the hour when the storms came in. And then so what I did is I kind of looked at some of each one of those alert days and looked at the peak hour, when it occurred, and what the drop was after the peak. And there was very, it was really trending, so it's very low. So it was anywhere from 0.5 to 3 megawatt decrease when you look at the peak hour and then the hour following the peak. Interestingly, on August 12th, if you look at the 4 o'clock hour, that RMLD hit a peak of 163, the following hour at 5 p.m., there was an 8 megawatt drop, which is significant.
Right.
Nowhere on any one of those other days was there such a significant drop. So we'll be able to tell, we'll be able to give an estimate of what we think the peak demand program achieved. However, it's very promising to me that when we're issuing a window of hours to see such a significant drop, and there was no weather, the temperature stayed and hovered around the 90 degree from 4 to 5. So we're trying to analyze that data and trying to extrapolate.
So that chart on the screen right now,
it's just July.
But it's just it's the peak day, right?
Correct.
Which day is that on the right?
That day was...
It's a day and hour in July, right?
Yep. I can't read it on my thing. If you look at your charts, it will tell you the peak hour and the day for each of those July dates on the bottom. I think, let me go back a couple.
It's not, but that's okay.
This one right here. So that occurred on July 22nd. I don't have the hour listed, but.
So I'm just curious.
I can tell you what the hour is. Hold on.
Going back to the slide you just had.
Yep, it was 1800, which was 6 p.m.
Okay.
Yep.
Going back to that one. So did you see a big drop after our push went out and that?
We're analyzing
okay,
that
you don't
right
know.
Now.
Okay.
Yeah, it's difficult to see. So what we're doing is we're looking at customer data, and we're looking at customers who opened emails. We're looking at customers who didn't open emails.
Right.
We sent tweets out.
Right.
And so there's no way to really track
right,
who's looking at a tweet and
leaving,
taking an action.
Leaving all that aside, mm-hmm. Did you see a big drop in demand? Forget about figuring out who did what, but did you see demand drop after
at that time of day? Yeah.
Yeah. After the big push, right? Did you see that the system was using less electricity?
It doesn't work that way.
All right.
Because everything is gradual. So as the day progresses, our load is continually climbing.
Right.
And it climbs to a point till it's at 8 o'clock.
Right.
And there's the only day that there was a significant drop was on August 12th from 4 to 5.
The rain.
Storm. No, that was a hot day. And that, and again, part of that could have been the shave of the peak. Part of that could have been
analog
a business closing. So we have to try to look at the data, but there's a lot of data points that you're trying to make assumptions on.
I guess all I'm asking is on. For any of those times when you did your big push, was there any little dip in the demand that looked unusual or not? It sounds like not.
We're too big to see that.
All right.
Or there was not a significant enough drop for us to,
okay,
to notice that.
So you don't know why on that particular day in July, the peak day in July, why the demand is so much lower than you would have expected based on the previous five Julys?
But correct.
You don't know why?
Correct.
But maybe what we did helped.
Correct.
Okay.
Jane, just because there'll be people listening, can you just briefly explain what the peak day, what the significance of that?
Sure. For RMLD on the wholesale power supplies, our capacity and our transmission costs are directly tied to the hour that the ISO New England peaks. So for a summer month, that 1 hour denotes how much capacity the RMLD is required to cover for the following 12 months beginning from June 1st to May 30th. So if the RMLD is able to reduce that amount with customer support, you know, solar, distributed generation, all the various programs that we have, that will reduce RMLD's overall power supply costs, which are a pass-through to our customers, which will lower their, which will maintain lower rates for our customers.
So they look at what that ISO peak amount
hours
is. And then?
Then RMLD is required to carry a certain amount of capacity plus reserve based on that amount that we used on that 1 hour.
Right. And I know you've told this a million times, but the actual dollar figure for each megawatt you can cut on the
right now with
peak,
the way costs are for this year, looking at what we would have saved, for each megawatt, it would be approximately $200,000.
$200,000. That's this year or that's next year? Because next year it's going to be worse, right? Where that is next year, because that's
next year, because it's based on this year's.
So each megawatt we can cut on the annual peak is worth $200,000.
That's with the preliminary information that we have.
And Jane, one just follow. Can
sure.
you just explain the cooling degree day?
Yeah, cooling degree looks at it's really a measure of load, and there's heating degree days in the winter and cooling degree days. So it's basically a calculation that it looks at the temperature, the average temperature for the day. So it takes the high temperature and the low temperature and it averages that out and it subtracts that from 65 degrees, which is the standard. So for example, if the average temperature for a day was 80 degrees, it would you take 80 minus 65 and you would get 15 cooling degree days. And that's a calculation that we track weather because weather impacts sales and demand consistently. And so by looking at that over the course of a month, so that's the cooling degrees for the month of July, it kind of will let you know how hot the month is.
Right.
And we use heating degree days for the winter periods.
Good.
I have one more slide.
Please.
This wasn't included in the packet, but I wanted to take the opportunity to inform our customers about our Solar Choice program. So we've got a couple of bullets here. RMLD has negotiated a contract for a 1 megawatt solar array located on Ballardville Street in Wilmington. And it's been, we've gotten a letter from the Department of Energy Resources, or the DOER, which signifies, thank you, Dave, that this could be treated as community solar. And so what that means is the SREC value is greater for that. And so the RMLD is developing a campaign, a new rate. It's called Solar Choice. It's taking the place of Green Choice. It's open to only 500 customers because of the size of the array. It's only a 1 megawatt, so we don't have unlimited solar that we can allocate. So the way the rate is structured is for the first 12 months, customers would pay on average a cost of $5 per month. And what that represents is the difference in the cost of the solar versus the average fuel charge. So the first 12 months, there'll be a line item on the customer's bill for $5. In month 13, what we'll do is we'll look back and determine how much value that solar array was on during the peak hour. And so whatever value that array contributed, those customers on that rate will get the capacity benefit for that. So that would be allocated towards those customers only. So in doing our estimations, it looks like on average in months 13 through the end of the term, customers would receive a credit on their bill as opposed to a charge of between $3 and $4. So over the course of a 10-year period, a customer who signs up for the Solar Choice rate would receive a net benefit of $300. That's the return on investment. And then the break-even point is basically during year three. So the $5 for the month in the first year would equate to $60 a year. Second month, they would be receiving a credit. If we estimate that between $3 and $4, that would be about $48. And then in year three, it would be also a credit is the forecast. And so going from years two through the term, 10 years, it would be a net credit on their bill. And so we're hoping that customers can go to our website. They can call customer service. And again, it's only limited to the first 500 customers who sign up.
It's live now, Jane?
Pardon me?
It's live now.
It's live now, yep.
Okay.
So we're going to be next month bringing you a rate that needs to be approved. It's going to be the Solar Choice rate. We're going to bring it to the CAB first. And it basically spells out what I've just discussed, where the first year, the average cost is a little higher than the fuel charge. So that works out to be approximately $5 a month. And then every year after, it's estimated that based on historical and some assumptions on the generation, there'll be a credit of between $3 and $4.
That's great. There's already been a...
We sent out a newsletter, and there was something in the newsletter just referencing...
I thought there was an email also for sign-up.
Tom.
I think that was just to the board and to employees.
Okay.
So we'll be sending direct emails out to our customers. Anyone that we have an email on file with, we'll be sending program information about the rate. And then we're also working on ways to educate that. I did a presentation to the Wilmington Library on how to save energy. And it was about 19 people that showed up and quite a few people in after explaining it to them and understanding after the first 12 months, it's a credit. We're very interested in quite a few of them signed up. So we're gonna get out more and try to explain it.
I think it's a great program.
Yeah.
Great. Sounds good.
Anything else, Jane?
Nope.
Any other questions for Jane?
Nope.
Okay, good.
I signed up. Did you guys sign up?
I did.
I'm going home tonight.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Good. Thank you, Jane.
Thank you, Jane.
You're welcome.
Good
very
stuff.
Exciting.
Okay. Amit, are you ready?
Yes, sure.
Okay.
My monitor's going out here. I need somebody to put me back online.
Good evening. I have a quick question for Jane before. Sure. How many other towns have any type of community solar? We have one, Wilmington now.
I don't know why it's going out.
We're one of the first. I know a couple of other municipalities.
I don't know. It died on its own.
Thanks for reminding me.
I didn't say anything that.
And that's all I'm aware of right now.
That's great.
Kind of died on me.
Awesome.
Good. Okay, let's give Amit our full attention.
Great. Thank you. I'm giving you the engineering and operations report for the month of July. The first slide, which Jane is going to show you, I guess.
It's good, Amit.
Great. Yeah. All right. The first slide is showing the capital improvement projects. That on the first column from the left, you see the projects. The second column shows you the percent completion, and the third column shows you the July spending, and the last one, the year-to-date spending for each one of those projects. And then the next category, the routine construction, you see all those subcategories that, you know, for month of July, the spending on the second column. And the last column shows you the spending for the year to date, which brings the total under this category to $132,977. The third slide is the routine maintenance. These are the number of maintenance programs that we started back in 2014, and it's been they're going really well. Transformer replacement program, which is all those transformers that over 20 years old, they were targeted and inspected, and we started replacing the aged transformers to stop the environmental disaster, number one, and also making sure the customer is not gonna impact the customer's reliability. The Padmont transformers, we've replaced approximately 20%. The overhead transformers, we've replaced so far approximately 14% of those that they're identified as aged or problematic. pole inspections for 2016. We inspected up to September 2016. 180 poles have been replaced. 102 of the 180 transfers have been completed thus far. This year also, we started another 640 poles, which is 10% of RMLD-owned poles. We just completed that, and I'm getting the report. Hopefully, we're going to give you that at the next board meeting. Visual inspection of the overhead lines. You see the number of circuits that visually were inspected for any potential problems. The next category is the manhole inspections. We started this program again last year, and so far 614 manholes have been inspected. We took pictures, and we are entering them into the GIS database so we can follow up with the maintenance of our assets in the underground, those manholes. Porcelain cutout replacement, that's 91% completed, 256 remaining to be replaced. The tree trimming, it's going very well. In July, 66 spans trimmed. The substation maintenance, we do monthly infrared scanning of all the equipment at the substations, and so far we haven't had any hotspots, anything that shows a sign of trouble. The next slide shows you the double poles, the ownership of, we have approximately 16,000 poles in our service territories. The ownership is 50-50, 50% RMLD, 50% Verizon. The custodial, however, varies from North Reading, and half of the Reading is RMLD's custodial, and Linfield and Wilmington is Verizon custodial territory. The next slide shows you an engine. This is the program that is shared between Comcast, Verizon, and RMLD, and also the towns, to know the status of the poles, the pole transfers, pole set poles, and pulling the poles, the pole butts out of the ground, basically. So this shows you that for Town and Linfield, we got 4 transfers. For RMLD, we got 15. For North Reading, RMLD has 15 transfers, 1 set pole, and 44 pool poles. In Reading, RMLD has the transfer 54. Pool poles, we got 30. In Wilmington, RMLD has 42 transfers, pool poles 4, and installing the guy is 1. These numbers, they go up and down, and we keep up with those as they surge. And with the pole replacement program, pole inspection program, I expect these numbers to rise, but we are keeping we are keeping up with them as they come up, and we have to replace the poles.
Can I make a comment?
Yes, please.
This engines program, you know, this ball in court, so that whoever's the custodial area puts in the pole, and then each party attacher gets notified. We're also doing a GIS data collection. We hope to be able to mesh the two. So I don't know that all of the poles have been collected. But I do know that there are double poles out there that are over 5 years old. Mm. And so I've asked Laurie Ann this week, Kathleen, to print off anything that's older than that, that's outside of our inspection programs. And it's going to probably be one of the things that I bring to the town managers to say, you know, here's all the ball in court for the fire department. This pole's been up there. They need to transfer. I need your help. Mm-hmm. If it's ball in court for Verizon, I'll write them a letter. And if that doesn't work, we'll be going to the selectmen for them and Comcast, and we'll have to take some kind of action for no future attachments, or I don't know. But again, electric is the first to transfer. So a lot of these poles that are out there, electric transfers first, and then we need to wait. And we're hoping that the engines would get people going. Wow. So whether it's not a complete list, because I think it was, wasn't it populated by Verizon? Who populated engines?
The engine was populated by the Verizon and Comcast.
Okay.
Right. They decided to transfer from the previous program that they had. And
yeah,
there were some problems with that. So.
But maybe at the next meeting, I'm probably going to show you a slide of, you know, the age of them.
Wow.
And what's the approach for where we have double poles? What's the philosophy of replacement?
When you put the second pole in?
Yeah.
Well, either the pole's been slated to be replaced because of age,
right,
or we've done an inspection and it's useful life,
right,
or it's been hit by a motor vehicle.
Right.
And Micho did the slide of custodial area. So either,
right,
Verizon or RMLD goes out and sets another pole. And then that goes into engines. Okay, a new pole's out there. Then a signal goes to RMLD. You're the first transfer. Then it goes to fire. Okay, we're done with it. Now it's your turn. Now it's your turn. Now it's your turn. And when it gets to the end of all the transfers, it goes back to the custodial, who goes back and gets a signal to take the pole butt out.
Okay, yeah. So that's the issue.
Some of these are stuck on transfers.
Who's the who's the most recalcitrant of the people who are supposed to be transferring?
Well, you can look up there and see that there's a little bit for everyone, but what's not up there is the age.
Right.
So what I'm saying is I'm looking at this every month, and we're making progress, but there are poles out there, double poles out there, that the age is starting to become an issue. So now that we have engines up and running, now is probably a time to, when I go talk to the town managers and stuff, to say, listen, we need some help with this.
But is the safety, because I've tried to picture, aren't the poles are attached to each other, correct?
In some cases,
yeah.
Some cases they're not.
Okay, so that's the safety issue, is where they're not, that the pole could.
The safety issues is if it's been slated as the end of its useful
condemned
life, and it's
right
rotted below,
yeah,
ground,
yeah,
you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Or the top's rotted, or it's been hit by a motor vehicle.
Right.
Usually if it's hit by a motor vehicle, they'll have the new pole lashed to the broken pole.
Mm.
Those usually get replaced.
Oh, that's not always done.
Not always,
okay,
but those usually get replaced fairly quickly because there's an insurance claim on that, and people,
right,
want their money.
Yep.
So we don't usually have a problem with them, but there are rare instances. But anyway, I'm going to be showing you age next time.
Okay.
That was my point.
Yep, good. Thank you, Colleen. Okay, Amit.
I guess the last slide shows you our reliability indices, SAIDI from 2011-2016, KD for the past 5 years, and SAIFI for the past 5 years. As you see in the category, the SAIDI, we are just the bar hit a little bit over the regional limit, but still under the national average. In the KD, we are under both of them, both under the regional and also national average. And in the SAIFI, we passed the bar for regional average, but still under the national average. The reason for that we went a little bit the bars, they went over the regional average, is because we've had the total number of storms that we've had this year so far been like 16. And we had number of back-to-back storm in January, from January 13th through January 23rd. And these are the large limbs of the wires that they came on the main feeder. And when it comes to the main feeder, you're talking about the long outage. That's why you see the KD, the duration of outage, that keeps going up. But because we got a large customer database, so you see the bar for the SAIDI, it's not going as fast or as tall as the KD. And depending on where the storm hits, which in our case, we've had number of unfortunate tree incidents that came down on main feeder. So we're talking about large, long customer hours. And these long customer hours, they raise the bar for the KD. Also, the frequency also goes up. That ties into the same, in the same manner. As you have more of the long hours of outages, it's going to be spread over your customer base, and it's going to make it sound or look like, you know, every customer saw more than what they normally would see under the normal conditions. In average, for the past 5 years, we've had like about 20, under 20 storms. But for this year so far, we've had, like, believe it or not, 16 of storm categories. It could be a snowstorm or rainstorm or, you know, the tornado or something that, you know, of that category that came through the town. Not all the communities were hit. Obviously, it looks like Reading is the attraction to all those nice storms. So that's the explanation for that. Otherwise, the reliability overall is good. The next slide shows you the outage causes for the 5 years average on the right side, and you see that, you know, the major categories of the outages were equipment, trees, and wildlife. If you look at the trees for 2016 from January to July, that shows that, you know, we actually exceeded our limit for 5 years average. The same thing in the wildlife category. We've had lots of animal contacts, but the equipment are going down because we are keeping up with the maintenance of the transformers and the porcelain cutouts and upgrading the wires, and so that's really paying off. And that concludes my report. If you have any questions, by all means.
Just a question, not for tonight, Amit, but you've been tracking, I know, the reliability study outcomes, and but just generally, are we doing pretty well? I know some of it's dependent on manpower and cash flow.
As we are going through these maintenance programs that we've initiated, we have implemented 10 different, in 10 different categories, 10 different maintenance programs. Yeah, as we going through those, yeah, it's getting better and better,
yeah.
But we are not out of the woods yet. Yep. Because this RMLD hasn't been maintained really for past 10 years or so.
Yep.
So we still got some issues at the substations. At the substations, we are getting better and better every day, every year. So in station four, we have upgraded the breakers. Right now, we're upgrading the relays. So that's going to be in good condition. Station three, we're going to be upgrading the relays. And as well as the LTCs for the transformer. At station five, we got some, it's an old substation. We're looking for land in Ballardville area, so hopefully we can find, so we can build a new substation. And that's gonna reinforce the reliability and bring more capacity to Wilmington area. However, station five, we're spending money to bring it not up to date completely because we're building new substations, but enough so to keep the system strength and reliability strong enough so we can, it would make us through building the new substation, which you're talking about 3 to 5 years period. But it's getting, overall, it's getting better and better, but you know, like what I said, 10 years of no maintenance, we got a way to go.
Yeah,
but you're making progress.
Maybe at a future meeting, you know, in advance of the budget process, it would be good to kind of revisit kind of what the scope was, because I'm sure there's also been discoveries we have had,
right,
to spend more than anticipated.
Yes.
So we can sort of see what some of your challenges are, and that, sure, might play into a budgeting process in terms of how much is allocated.
By all means, I guess we're gonna have to report also on the recommendations that were made from the reliability study.
Okay, good.
So that
would fit in perfectly. Yeah. Good. Okay. Thank anything you. Else for Amit? Okay.
Thank you.
You have something?
Give the bids to me.
You the bid.
You want to do the bids?
More than 10 years out there for the past.
Want to do those now or after Wendy?
The substations haven't maintained for 10 years.
All right. Yeah. Okay. Wendy, you'll pause for a moment. We're going to give Amit a little more face time so he can
thank you.
Have his bids reviewed.
Are you going to do the bids now?
Maybe approved.
Right, great.
Okay. All right. So, Bill, you...
I've lost my computer again.
Okay.
I've hit the wrong button. Poor dinosaurs like me. Hit the wrong button. This one I did.
You want to use
the I can use. I can use the paper.
Yeah.
Okay. I got paper. Okay. You ready for the
mine?
battery bank? First one.
Yep.
Move with the proposal 2017-12 for battery bank at substation 4 be awarded to Wesco as the most advantageous and responsive proposer on the recommendation of general manager for a total cost of $24,000 even.
Okay, do you have a second?
Second.
Okay, anything you want to?
These are the battery banks for station four. They supply the power to our relays for protection scheme. and those batteries are at the end of their useful life. So this is going to, as part of the upgrades that we're talking about. The substations, I just want to make another corrections. Substations hadn't been maintained for 10 years before we got, I got so.
Wow.
And long before then, the distribution system. So there is, so we got a way to go.
Okay, any discussion? None appearing, we'll have a vote. All in favor? Okay, motion carries 401. Bill?
Move the proposal 2017-14 for 1/0 triple X service cable be awarded to Wesco as the most advantageous and responsive proposer on the recommendation of the general manager. The term of the contract is for 1 year with an option for additional second or third year at the sole discretion of the Reading Municipal Light Department for a total cost of $507,600.
Okay, second?
Second.
Okay, Amin?
This is part of the secondary service and connections upgrade. As you know, we got some areas that you know well, they had neutral problems and the services were old, so we started another maintenance program. This is our 10th maintenance program to upgrade the services and the wires and also the connectors at both house end and the street end. And we're going through lots of wires in order to do that, which that's what this bid is for, basically.
Yeah. How many bids do we receive on that, Amit, do you recall?
On this one, yes, we received 14 bids. Five responded. Two of them, they came at a tie, Graybar and Wesco. So we gave them another opportunity to, you know, to rebid again. And then Wesco came out as a responsive bidder. Graybar was lower. However, they said they're going to maintain that price for 3 years if we commit to 3 years. We don't want to commit to 3 years because the price of the wires are going up and down, mm-hmm. and you don't know whether you're going to win or you're going to lose, and right. the future is on hold. So the responsive bidder was Wesco, so for 1 year commitment.
Any discussion? On the hearing, we'll take a vote. All in favor? Motion carries 401. Bill?
Okay, move that bid 2017-17 for 1 sport utility vehicle, SUV in parentheses, with trade-in be awarded to Stoneham Motor Company for $22,606 as the lowest responsive and responsible bidder on the recommendation of general manager.
Second.
Okay, thank you, Dave.
Yeah, these are for, we had 14 bidders, and three bidders responded, the Chrysler, Colonial Chevrolet, and Stoneham Ford. So these, the lowest responsive bidder was Stoneham Ford.
Okay, is this part of the fleet?
That's a SUV, yeah, for the replacing one of the older vehicles.
What's happening with the older vehicle? Is that going to be going the trade-in? Is that what we're doing?
That's going to be going, yes.
Yeah,
we'll be trading and as a reward. Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Any other
this
discussion?
Is the sport utility vehicle okay. with trade-in be awarded, right?
That's the Prius. Is
that's a Prius, yeah, in. That's right. Prius. The SUV.
Okay.
It's going to replace the Prius.
Okay.
Correct.
That's right.
Yeah. The bid is for the SUV, it's with
that's
a
right.
With
this
a Prius
should have been written so that it said Calmer 2005 Toyota Prius, which was what was written on the.
Okay.
So should that be part of the motion then?
I think for surplus
yeah.
and stuff like that and for
right.
trade-ins, we should definitely. I actually had changed the letter, so I'm looking for the letter right here
okay.
because it was missing it. 1 second, let me find it.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, so on the actual letter, it says a bid invitation was placed. We're soliciting bids for 1 sport utility vehicle SUV with a trade-in 2005 Toyota Prius.
Yeah.
2005?
2005, yep.
Yeah.
Okay, shall we?
And the trade-in values, I think, are shown, right? 3,000, 4,000, and 5,007 for Stone and Motor.
So if we need to add afterwards where it says with trade-in,
With 2005?
With trade-in of 2005 Toyota Prius?
Correct.
Okay, I will accept that as part of the main motion. If the secondary will accept it also.
I will accept that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Any other discussion?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Hearing all in favor? Motion carries 401.
Okay, ready?
One more, Phil.
Move the proposal 2017-18 for Sikkim. Is that pronounced that right?
Sikkim.
What?
Sikkim.
Okay. Insulation piercing connectors be awarded to Wesco as the most advantageous and responsive proposer on the recommendation of the general manager. The term of the contract was for 1 year with an option for additional second or third year at the sole discretion of the Reading Municipal Light Department for a total cost of $306,000 even.
Okay.
This
second?
Second.
Okay.
Yeah, the Sikkim connectors are, as again, as part of the connections replacements for both at the end, at the house end, and the pole on the street end.
Yeah.
So they go hand in hand with the one or triplex cable that we are upgrading the services. The bid was sent to 20 bidders, and three responded, Wesco, Graybar, and Stuart Irby. And the lowest responsive bidder was the Wesco.
I mean, given that they got 2017-14 bid, it sounds like it would be impractical to go to a separate bidder anyway, right? Or could you? I'm just saying, in addition to being the lowest responsive bidder,
right,
the fact that they're handling the other bid, it sounds like they're complementary, or is that true?
The bidder is Wesco. They had the three, that was for, Wesco came out as $306,000.
Yep.
Graybar came out at $322,680, and Stuart Irby came out at $342,000.
Good. Any questions or discussion? None appearing. All in favor? And motion carries 401. I think we covered all the bids. I think
yep,
we have.
We're good.
Okay. Amit, anything else to
that's
report?
It. Thank Except you. Amit, that's Thank a lot you have on your plate there, and those all that inspections and replacements is really impressive.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's good stuff. Takes a while to make up for neglect.
Yeah, it does. It's actually, yeah, it's longer than 10 years because when I came over on board, we had the substations, they hadn't been maintained basically for over 10 years.
Mm.
But the maintenance programs that we have initiated, they're addressing those, as well as the reliability study really helped to make sure that, you know, we are on the right track, which came to 95% match to what we had already identified.
Which was good.
So good. We're making progress.
Great. Nice. Thank you, Amit.
Thank you.
Okay, Wendy. We saved the best.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Fortunately for you, I won't bore you with financials. Tonight was supposed to be the financial presentation of FY16, but due to the deferred pension liability calculation and the length of the actuarial to get to that, we have to postpone it to October 20th. But the audit itself took place the week of August 8th, and the auditors from Melanson Heath were out here for about 3.5 field days. It was very organized, and they were very impressed with, you know, how quick we were to respond to their questions. And they said that there were no major findings.
Good.
Just some very incidental ones, and no management letter to follow. So they will be out here to present next board meeting.
Right.
With that being said, after FY16 is presented, we will, as in the past, we will catch up with the first quarter of FY17 financials in the November meeting. That's what we're proposing to do. Other than that, I don't think there's anything else to report tonight.
Can I make a comment?
Yes.
The actuarial we're doing now with the town, so that both
yes,
RMLD and the town are both waiting on that data.
That's
it's
right.
It's not anything that we're holding up.
Yep. Okay, this may not be an answerable question, Wendy, but just based on kind of the flow of inputs and outputs, anything that's caught your eye in terms of either things the board should be aware of in terms of revenues or may be hard to tell. I know we don't have all the
I think it's very consistent with what we've been reporting month after month, which is really good. And the only thing that will change the financials is the actual calculation. It doesn't look like it's so significant that it's going to have a large impact as of right now. We just got some preliminary numbers, and we're going to put it together and get good, solid financials for you.
Great. Any other questions for Wendy?
Nope.
Okay, good. Thank you, Wendy. We'll see you next month.
All right, thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. So, next meetings. We have a meeting Thursday, October 20th, board meeting, and that has a two parts, sorry, Gina, three parts, I guess. We have the audit report.
The audit committee before, right?
Yeah, and then our second, our executive
right.
session. But
right.
Yep. Okay, and then I think the plan is, because of the timing of the meetings with respect to the holidays and Thanksgiving, particularly November, we will transition from October 20th to the 15th of December for our board meeting after that. So everyone seem okay with those two dates while we're gathered?
Yeah. The October 20th date does not work. Jeannie knows that. I can't do the October 20 date, but I could do the 15th.
Okay. All right. Good. And then, as I said, as indicated, we have the audit meeting on October 20th preceding our board meeting. And we have a CAB meeting on October 12th, Wednesday. So are we in need of someone? Okay.
So you need somebody?
Yeah.
I can do that.
Okay. That way there you won't feel like you missed anything, Dave.
Yeah,
in October.
Exactly. I'll make up.
Yep.
You make up for it, right.
October 12th.
Yep. All right.
Yeah, go ahead.
And under general discussion, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, please.
Just briefly, so we had the NEPA conference last month. And there's just been a little sideline chats about some of the content at the conference that we might want to respond to, one of which was that they had a guy who denies all of climate science appear and merits some type of response, I think, from the board.
Okay.
And then perhaps other things that it was we might have some input for them as a board.
Okay. Phil, I know you were there. Did you have anything else you want to?
No, I think Dave kind of summarized it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, good. How about you, Colleen? You weren't there.
She wasn't there.
Okay.
On the positive side, there was I was facilitating a discussion about a battery project in Sterling Municipal Light Department, and that was very interesting. And they have a project that's really cutting edge in the nation, and that Sandia National Labs and DOE is looking at. That actually hasn't been built yet, but it's something to watch. So I'm hopeful that, you know, this time, in another few months, they'll have a project that's really one to watch for all of us. Similar to our gas generator, we could maybe have a battery with the similar economics that would be energy storage in the form of a big lithium ion battery.
So we'll stay tuned on that.
Everybody was very interested in that.
Dave, is that all about peak shaving?
Battery?
That's
big
all
time.
Yeah.
Yeah, and if you have lots of solar, there could be times when, you know, it's 1 p.m. on a blazing June day on a Sunday, and there's very little demand, and you might have more solar generation at certain moments that could absorb.
It could absorb
a battery could
power.
Absorb that, too. Concord has that problem, or is about to have that problem now. They've got a huge array. And they've told me that on such times, they've actually had that array powers 100% of the load on that particular circuit that it's on. And so any more, and that's only on, those rare
sunny days.
Sunny day when it's a Sunday and there's very little demand in, you know, May or something.
Right.
So these interesting things are going to be coming up. And so the batteries, as we all know, are going to be really important for electric grids. And so the Sterling project is very important.
Interesting.
Nice.
Yeah.
Colleen, can you give a soundbite on NEPA for our listening audience? Some probably people don't know what NEPA is other than an acronym. So.
What NEPA is?
Yeah, just as the little background on the organization.
Public Power Authority. It's probably a collaborative effort of all of the municipal utilities in all of the New England states and some parts of New York. They'd get together and, you know, a lot of the topics that are shared and collaborative efforts are around training and education, legislative. They do a lot with helping to ensure that we're not passed by during legislative acts that would hurt the municipals. There's a number of topics.
Yeah.
You know, it's an arena that you can bring different information to.
Yeah, I think it's been helped. We've typically had at least a couple of board members, and you and your staff attend the meetings, which I think is helpful in terms
of best
practices.
The good part is, you know, the thing that I enjoy is networking with different people.
Yeah.
And seeing what they're doing and talking to them. You know, I forget who the people we talked about, the gas generator that put it in place. I can't remember which.
Middleborough.
Mm-hmm. I got a chance to talk with them and get their experiences. So it was interesting, you know, networking time.
There is always that serendipitous. How much training do we do at NEPA in terms of staff here? Is trained up in Littleton or has trained by NEPA?
Well, NEPA runs, we here have a line worker and technician apprentice program that we certify our employees with. But we augment with NEPA for their networking of the linemen. They also run the theoretical portion, which comes out of Northwest Linemen's College, where the linemen, you know, do the classroom work. Because there's a bunch of components to both the technician and the line workers in achieving a journeyman status. They do substations, metering, almost all of the topics in operations, and then we work with ECME for a lot of the engineering, keeping the engineers' career developments up to speed. In addition to that, we have annual retraining with NEPA where we get pole-top rescue, confined space entry, CPR first aid, because everyone here has to be certified either every year or every other year in a number of topics. American Public Power Association Safety Manual is our adopted safety program. There's a lot that goes into it.
Good. Any other points for discussion? Yes, Dave.
A couple of things that stood out to me at this meeting was one of them was the audit and how it was discussed, and there's no management findings and everything looks good. I think that shows that RMLD is financially doing a great job with the ratepayers' money. So
yep.
Congratulations there. The other one that stood out to me was the maintenance equipment that's failing less and less and less, and that's personally, based on the experience I've had in my career with utilities, preventive maintenance goes a long way. And that's another fact of RMLD's taking the stand to look out for the ratepayers. So it's just something to say thank you for.
Good point, Dave. Yeah, thank you, Dave.
Thank you.
Good insights. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And thanks for your participation tonight. Okay.
Okay.
Mr.
We ready to go into executive session?
Gina, please.
Okay.
Motion. This will be a roll call vote.
Roll call vote, yes, Mr. Chairman. Move that the board go into executive session to approve the executive session minutes of May 12th, 2016, May 26th, 2016, June 30th, 2016, and July 28th, 2016, and discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining and return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor, roll call vote.
Mr. Talbot, aye.
Mr. Pacino, aye.
Mr. O'Rourke, aye.
Mr. Hennessy, aye.
Yep, very good.
Okay. Meeting adjourned.